This is the most urgent of times and the most urgent of messages.
Welcome to Sismic, a podcast about a fast-changing world.
What is real? How do you define real?
Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind.
We are in the beginning of a mass extinction.
It's about everyone. It's about all of us. It's about potential. It's about possibility.
The singularity is probably the right word because we just don't know what's going to happen.
How dare you!
Hello, Mr. Meadows, and thanks a lot for accepting my invite.
Well, my pleasure. Thank you.
So let's jump into this. I mean, almost 50 years ago, in 1972, you and your team from the MIT published a report on the exponential economic and population growth with a finite supply of resources studied by a computer simulation. And the title was The Limits to Growth, also known today as the Meadows Report, since both you and your wife were among the four co-authors. And the report concluded that without substantial changes in resource consumption, the most probable result will be a rather sudden and uncontrollable decline in both population and industrial capacity. And then you updated the report again in 1992, and it was updated again 10 years later. But the conclusion doesn't change. And so this is, of course, what I want to be spending time, you know, the next hour talking about. Can you start by clarifying what this work is about? What is this report and the methodology and the main ideas and conclusions?
Of course, it's difficult to compress 2 years of work in a 2 or 3 minute response, but I do my best to give the overview. It's impossible to remember now, probably, but in 1970, the general expectation everywhere, certainly in the rich developed countries, was that population and economy and quality of life and the environment would just continue to improve more or less indefinitely, certainly for as long forward as we care to look. But that is impossible. Growth can't continue forever in a finite world. Even a planet as big as ours does have limits. And so in order to get a better perspective, I put together a team of 16 scientists at MIT, where I was a professor. And we spent about a year and a half understanding some of the basic laws that govern growth in population and material consumption. It's impossible to predict the future, of course, because humans look at what's happening and they take actions, and then that action, which typically can't be predicted, will influence the way things go. So it's impossible to predict what's going to happen, but it is possible to predict many things which are impossible. As a trivial example, I could predict that during this interview, neither you nor I will suddenly lose gravity and float up off our chairs. I don't know where you will be exactly 3 or 4 minutes from now, but you will not be floating in the air 10 feet above your chair, nor will I. So our goal was not to make a precise prediction, but rather to show a range of possible futures. And because these factors, population, economy, and so forth, move slowly, we looked at a period of 200 years, from 1900 up until 2100. The period from 1900 until 1970, where we did our work, gave us some historical perspective. And the period from 1970 to 2100 was the length of time where we felt it would be possible to give some useful insights, which could possibly be of use to policy makers and others. So we created these laws. We found these laws. We put them into a computer model using a method called system dynamics, which focuses not on the precise variables, but on their behavior. again, to use an example, if I were to throw a ball into the air, I couldn't tell you precisely where it's going to land, but I do know it's going to slow down and then start accelerating towards the planet. I know pretty much about the dynamics, although I don't know about the precise details. And it's the same thing for the world. We created 13 different possible futures for the world. They ranged from quite attractive ones, where physical growth levels out at sustainable levels. The population becomes quite high quality of life. Pollution is kept under control and so forth. Those were the attractive scenarios. And we also saw possibilities where nothing would be done. Growth would continue for a while until it surpassed the possibilities for sustainable support, and then would come back down again. The latter was the more spectacular, and so it, of course, became the one that the media used to characterize our report. And although I don't think we ever used the term collapse in our work, because that implies a lot of things outside our scientific interest and competence, we used the term uncontrollable decline. A reduction in population, a reduction in material standard of living, a reduction in food consumption, perhaps, in and so forth, which is outside the control of humanity. It's under the control of physical laws, of course, but it's not the sort of thing that the politicians want. So we talked about those things. And we published the work. Actually, we published three reports. Limits to Growth, the one you referred to, was a so-called popular report. It, quite to our surprise, was picked up and translated into 35 languages and eventually sold over 3 million copies. Our scientific report, a really big 600-page document that gives all of our data and our computer equations and so forth, was much more narrowly distributed. Actually, I often thought that it would have saved me time just to bring together in a room everybody who was interested in our scientific work and just tell them about it, rather than go to all the trouble of writing a 650-page book about it. And so then in 1992, we updated the report. We looked at new data. We made some slight improvements in our understanding of how technology advances. We generated a new set of scenarios. They are almost identical to the ones that existed in 1972, because, of course, the physical laws hadn't changed. And then more recently in 2004, we did the third report. There won't be a fourth report because now it's no longer possible to generate all those scenarios. The attractive scenarios are no longer really available to us.
Well, thanks for trying to summarize this. I know it's a tough exercise because it's a big study. But what's very astonishing, you know, with this work is that the things that you are talking about are still very much what is discussed today. Again, you know, as this is becoming visible. You know, some of the things that you're predicting are now here, and this is why also we need to talk about this work, because it's like you've been talking about this for so many years and we still talk about it. First of all, you know, I would like to understand how it was received, first in the 70s, then in the 90s, you know, when the first results came out, because it was discussed indeed. So what were the reactions, the objections, and the things you spend a lot of time discussing, and if anything was done about it?
Well, the response to our book hasn't changed very much until very recently. It's only with now the accelerating impact of climate change, the pandemic, and other problems that people are beginning to contemplate this idea that there might actually be limits to growth. For the first 40 years, from 1970 up until 2010, it was pretty much the same. And there were, I would say, three different types of responses. The more enlightened politicians, Sigmund Mansholt, who was heading the European Union in the early days, the original Trudeau leading Canada, Jimmy Carter, president of the United States, and a number of the European leaders took it seriously and tried to understand what could be done to head the world down a more attractive path. The second response came from economists who almost universally criticized and condemned the report because if you accept that there are limits to growth, then you have to say that modern economics is by and large irrelevant because it's a science of trying to tell people how to promote growth. Certainly macroeconomics is all about that. And then there were the short-sighted politicians who basically found our results inconvenient because growth is the way a politician, a hack politician, mediates between competing demands. If you have three or four people sitting around you who want more than currently exists, you can tell them to go along with you and later all of them will have more. But if it's clear that there is not going to be more, that the growth has stopped, then that kind of compromise becomes impossible. So the short-sighted politicians basically tried to change the point of view, and they were the ones who said, well, you're trying to stop growth before the poor countries become rich, or you're trying to unfairly stabilize population in the poor country, etc. They really tried to change the point of discussion. More recently, it's been fascinating to me to watch the evolution of debate on climate change. We didn't predict climate change in our original book. We mentioned it. But in 1972, it wasn't much of an issue. And it's not in itself a problem. It's a symptom. But anyway, as you watch people, the way people are talking about climate change, there's a growing recognition that we may have unleashed forces which are really outside our control and that there were limits to the amount of greenhouse gases we could put into the atmosphere. Unfortunately, we're already past them.
So let's go back to what's happening now. So like, because most of your predictions were right, you know, at least the one prediction saying that what will happen if we do nothing, basically, you know, one of your scenario, which is kind of the worst case scenario. And we have grown our economy like crazy, the population, standards of living, and along with it, the impact on the planet. And we're already seeing the consequences, some of the consequences. And yet the idea that there are limits to growth, that there may be limits to growth, that growth is and also the idea that growth is correlated to the challenges we have to face, this idea is still marginalized. And a couple of years ago, we even had William Nordhaus, who got a Nobel Prize, basically saying that we can grow forever and that climate change can even be good for us. How do you feel about that? And what do you think this is still happening there? We're still telling, you know, that this is forever. How is it so difficult to grasp?
I find it useful to remember that although you and I are sitting here talking to each other thousands of miles apart with all the modern technology, still biologically, cognitively, you and I and all the rest of the people in our species are the result of 200,000 years of evolution, minimum. And that the way we view things comes out of a set of habits which were helpful to our ancestors 10, 20, 50, 100,000 years ago. That's how long it takes to evolve. In ancient times, you didn't spend a lot of effort looking at long-term problems, trying to figure out the solution for things that were going to happen 10 years in the future. You were watching out for dangerous animals and getting ready to run. It means that today we're trying to deal with long-term problems using a mental apparatus which evolved to deal with short-term problems. And it just isn't working. It's almost impossible for people to put their current situation in the context of what will exist 40, 50, 60 years into the future. It's impossible to imagine that things aren't just going to keep getting better. It's impossible to imagine that our species is not somehow the most important thing on the planet. And so we're just ill-equipped for it. How do I cope with that? Well, I'll I'm being a little facetious, but I'll mention it. So one attitude I've adopted is the point of view, which is, well, it's a minor planet anyway. You know, Earth is actually, in the overall scheme of things, not that important. And so what's happening here isn't actually going to make that much difference. So don't get so excited about it. I remember somebody, and plus our role on the planet is not that important. I was talking recently with a friend who got very concerned about the problems I was addressing. And he said, well, we have to save the planet. And I said, no, we don't have to save the planet. The planet will save itself. It's always done that over the last 200 million years. It's saved itself whenever there was a problem. An asteroid hits it or volcanoes erupt or whatever. It slowly reestablishes a new equilibrium. It'll do that again. What's of concern to us is trying to save some elements that we consider important about our civilization. And that should be the focus. So I have narrowed my focus and am no longer trying to avoid a decline, because I think that's in the cards. It's probably underway already anyway. Certainly for some people it is. And rather, we need now to move over to, instead of pursuing sustainability, thinking about resilience, how you structure a system, your family, your house, your business, your community, whatever, to adjust to the shocks that are coming from climate change, coming from the future versions of the pandemic and so forth.
Yeah, we'll go into this, but I want to mention something, because when I first asked you about this interview and I explained to you about my podcast and you accepted, but at the same time, you wrote me one interesting thing, which is that, and I quote you, that you consider conversations of the sort to be mainly entertainment for those who already share our basic ideas. And it's fun to hold them, but then you don't change anyone's opinion about anything. And I thought that's an interesting point of conversation, because what do you think then of those still trying to change things, you know, the activists of all sorts fighting for these topics to be heard, discussed, and dealt with? Are we just wasting time? Is it the wrong topic, the wrong questions that you mentioned?
No.
Or are they doing it wrong?
No. So I'm, I was a teacher for 50 years. My joy, my goal was to help people keep an optimistic, constructive attitude about the future and understand things they could do. No matter what the situation, there always will be possibilities to make the future either worse or better than it would have been otherwise. You may not any longer be able to get the future precisely as you want, but amongst those that are available to you, some are more attractive than others. And I think it's the joy and the ethical obligation of all of us to do those things we can to achieve the better outcomes. So what does that mean? Well, I'll share two ideas which I tell to people who are looking for guidance about what to do. First, I think that instead of pursuing sustainability, which at least as we define it is no longer really an option for global society, look for ways to increase resilience. Look for ways to increase the capacity to cope with surprising shocks as they come along. We know that the rate at which disruptions are coming is increasing. We know that the magnitude of those disruptions is increasing, whether from climate change, from the escalating nuclear debate, or for changes in the energy, whatever, they are coming. And it's useful, possible, and satisfying to increase your capacity to deal with them, despite that you don't know exactly what they are. So resilience rather than sustainability is the first concept. The second concept is what I would call universal rather than global problems. Global problems are those issues which confront all of humanity but they can only be dealt with through concerted action by all the players. So climate change, nuclear proliferation, coping with a pandemic, these are global problems. There's no way that you can solve climate change in France by yourself unless also the other nations of the world do it as well. There's no way, as we've discovered, that you can insulate yourself from a pandemic unless we bring the pandemic down to zero everywhere. Those are global problems. Universal problems affect everybody, but they can be dealt with locally. So water pollution is a problem everywhere in the world. But in France, or in the United States, or in South Korea, or in a small village, you can eliminate water pollution. And you get immediately the benefits from that. So universal problems are politically much more tractable. There, the leadership can say that if you make sacrifices now, soon you here will see the benefits. Global problems are politically intractable. There, the leaders have to say, if you make sacrifices here and now, most of the benefits are going to go someplace else later. And that doesn't happen to be a platform on which most politicians can get reelected. So they don't like to do it. Therefore, if somebody wants to be actively engaged, I'd say seek ways of increasing resilience and focus on universal rather than global problems.
So I want to take an example, you know, with climate change, because this conversation is also about what is the right problem, you know, that we should be tackling. Because if we talk about climate change, since it is considered to be, you know, the most discussed thing of the time, if growth stops and indeed the decline of the population, of the economy and of our consumption of energy, you know, happens, we are then addressing the issue of climate change and part of the environmental crisis kind of mechanically. And then would you say that climate change is the most pressing issue, or should we instead talk about the consequences of that decline and how to maintain, you know, a functioning civilization here and there? And if I hear you well, there is also a matter of at what level we do it, locally, globally.
I think, first of all, it's important to understand that climate change is not in itself a problem. It's a symptom. The problem is continued physical growth of population and material consumption in a finite world. And one consequence of that continued growth is climate change. But soil erosion, the pandemic, and many other things are also symptoms of what happens when you stress the ecosystem. So, you know, it's kind of like if you have a friend who has cancer and the cancer gives them headaches. Of course, you'd like to get rid of the headache, but you don't imagine that the headache is the problem. The headache is a symptom. It may be useful to give aspirin to the person, but you don't imagine that you've solved their problem. You've simply alleviated the symptom. In order to get rid of the cancer, you have to focus on it directly. In order for us to get rid of the cancer of continued growth, we need to focus on it directly. You said if growth slows. Well, I have news for you. Growth is slowing, and it's going to continue to slow in the future. There's virtually no chance that the kind of growth rates which we experienced, let's say in the 1990s, will continue. Exactly when growth will stop and start to decline is not clear. And of course, it will differ in various parts of the world. In some countries, already population growth is going down. In other countries, it probably will continue to grow for another 20, 30 years or more. People will experience it differently in the different places. But throughout, I would say by the end of this century, population on this planet material consumption, energy use, food production, all the indicators of physical activity will be much lower than they are today.
What's astonishing also is that we, and if I hear you, is that we have almost no chance, according to you, to voluntarily limit our growth and therefore address, you know, that the root of the issue. And therefore, if I hear you, you say that will continue on in some places, but that will keep going until we just cannot do it anymore, yeah. Growing. Is that correct?
Yeah. Remember earlier you said, or you used the term, your predictions were correct. Actually, we didn't make predictions. We laid out 13 different possibilities. One of the possibilities showed growth peaking out in this period between 2020 and 2050, and then declining more or less indefinitely. We didn't predict that that was going to happen, but according to several studies which have looked at empirical data over the last 30 or 40 years and compared it with our different scenarios, that is, in fact, the future which seems to lie ahead of us. Growth, to say that growth is going to come down is in itself not a cause for alarm, because it's perfectly imaginable that we would bring it down through actions that we undertake and with consequences that we find relatively acceptable. Take population, for example. Population grows when the birth rate is bigger than the death rate. If you want population to go down, it will, one way or another, which means that the birth rate will become smaller than the death rate. There are two ways to achieve that. One is that we can deliberately reduce the birth rate, or the other is we can just step back, ignore the problem, and let the environment change in ways that increases the death rate. The first is attractive, the second isn't. We still have that choice in theory.
Let's go into resilience, which is now what you say should be the thing that we should be focused on, basically. Which is this is going to happen, you know, whatever we kind of do. So we need to prepare for the consequences. How should a nation state, for example, prepare for it? And do you think that indeed the political systems in place allow such a, you know, a nation state to actually do it?
There has been a tendency to approach these problems, the pandemic, for example, or climate change, as though there needs to be some policy change at the top level. And if just the nation states could do it one way instead of another, if we could just change the government a little bit, then finally these problems would be resolved. That's simply not true. The fundamental problem is at the level of the individual. As long as an individual tends to measure progress as a rate of change, or by comparing their situation to their neighbor, who of course is at the same time comparing his situation with theirs, as long as we have that kind of a system, it is going to drive itself to collapse, because it's simply not suited to pursue sustainability, to stop growth. I think any governmental system is compatible with sustainability. Any governmental system could lead you to resilience. And I mean democracies, dictatorships, monarchies, tribal hierarchies, all the different ways of governance that we've tried over the last couple hundred thousand years. Any of them in theory could be acceptable, but not if they're led by people who have a short-term perspective and who are actively pursuing growth. When I point out that democracy has not in any meaningful way coped with climate change, people assume that I'm advocating for a different form of government, dictatorship or communism or, you know, whatever. No, I'm actually, personally, I'm delighted to live in a democracy, happy I grew up in one. To recognize it has problems isn't to say that somebody else wouldn't have just as many problems. And I think all of them will have until we manage to change our perspective. I think what's going to happen is that we won't change our perspective. And I foresee that the system is now in a period of disintegration, decoupling, to the point where in a century or two, we'll be back down to small groups who are able to pursue their situation in a much more narrow context. Now, one of the terribly difficult aspects of our current situation is that actions taken by the United States or by France ricochet out and have global consequences. You know, 2,000 years ago, we had three great civilizations, the Chinese, the Persian, the Romans. Any one of them could rise and fall without causing many consequences for the other. Now, a trader in the United States, a financial trader, can execute some computer instruction and collapse the economy of another country. We're just not equipped for coping with that level of interdependence. And I think what's going to happen is that the system will evolve in a way that is no longer necessary.
So what you're predicting is kind of the end of the civilization as we know it, and we're going back to something that is different, that is still to be invented. And
please don't use the word prediction. You can predict an eclipse of the moon, but you can't predict the future for the human society. You can, as I said, you can say some things which are not going to happen, but there's a wide range of possible futures. I think it's important to remember, I'm almost 80 years old. I grew up in a world very different from this one. I grew up in a world where energy consumption per capita was a small fraction of what it is today. Jet travel didn't exist. There were no computers. You know, so I know that it's perfectly possible to have a functioning society with happy, liberally minded, equitably distributed people under circumstances very different from today. If I tell someone today that they should reduce their energy consumption by half, I did that recently, and the person's immediate response was, "Oh, you want us to go back to the Stone Age?" I said, "No, I'd like to go back to the 50s. I grew up in the 50s. It was a perfectly wonderful time. And the energy consumption was less than half of what it is today." So there are so many possibilities. Over the last 200,000 years, our species has experienced many of them, and it's hopefully going to experience many more of them over the next 200,000 years. But it won't experience the kind of high energy, high material welfare, high consumption society which those of us in the rich, principally white North have come to accept as inevitable and desirable. What will it be? I don't know. Interesting question.
So I'm wondering, because indeed you say you're talking also like to a lot of students and you still give some, you know, conferences. What is a good question to address then? Is it about how do we adapt? How do we get ready? How do we prepare to something that is very different? Instead of trying to make things sustainable, how do you frame that question?
I would say the important question is, how do we make people care about the distant future and care about people who are far away and different from them? If that level of concern could come to each of us, we would create political systems, technologies, even modes of economy that would achieve those goals. You know, people have been looking for the solution to climate change, for example, through making minor adjustments to the current political and economic system. The current political and economic system is an expression of the goals and the will of the people. And if you don't change those, you're not going to change the results it produces. You know, I'm always amused. One of the big debates these days is about genetically modified organisms. And the proponents of using genetics to create new tell us, well, this will cure problems of hunger. That's just silly. The problems of hunger have been created by a group of institutions who, given a more powerful tool, are going to still create hunger. We could eliminate hunger today with the technologies we have today if people cared enough to do it. They don't. So the crucial question is, how do we change ourselves? If we change ourselves, our systems will change. If we don't change ourselves, we can change our systems all we like, and they're still going to give us the same result.
Do you have any idea? Because this is about changing the culture, if I hear you. No, because if you want to change people in a mass scale, that's about changing how you look at the world. So it's about the culture. Do you have any idea how to start doing that?
So religion has been traditionally the way people have formed and propagated their collective ethic. There are many different religions, Hinduism, Islam, Buddhism, Shinto, Christianity, and so forth. I would look to the religions. Some of the old religions, Buddhism, for example, has had to internalize some of the ethics required for a sustainable society. If a religion doesn't give you the ethics you need to promote sustainable behavior, the religion is going to die away. And so I would look to some of the more traditional religions for some guidelines about this. And I say that even as a scientist who tends to have a relatively objective view of the world. Nonetheless, spiritualism plays an absolutely essential role, and that's where I would look. People look up, people are sometimes saying, well, what technology do we need? What new tool do we need? I would say that's premature to ask that question. What we need is a longer time horizon. We need personally and through our institutions to internalize a procedure, habits, and mechanisms for putting our current actions in the context of their very long-term consequences. Today, you know, a politician will evaluate alternatives in terms of how well they'll look between now and the next election. If they can just make things look a little bit better off between now and the next election, they stand to win. If I go to a politician and tell them, here's the right thing to do, but it's going to make things worse for a couple decades before the situation improves, they will have no interest, because pursuing that would make it impossible for them to remain in power.
Here you have an example of how a system works can prevent change from happening, kind of mechanically.
Yes, oh, absolutely. I mean, it's one of the severe difficulties of our situation. So we have evolved these very elaborate systems, technical systems, economic systems, governmental systems. They are not giving us a sustainable future. Manifestly, I mean, that's not any longer a debatable question. You know, just look at the annual increase in CO2 emissions. Clearly, these systems of governance are not working for the long term. But those same systems generate enormous power, enormous wealth for many constituencies. Take the oil companies. The oil companies have made, you know, billions and billions of dollars promoting policies which actually are not in the long-term sustainable interest of society, but they're great for the stockholders of the oil companies in the short term. Now, whenever there is a politician or other leader who starts to promote a rational policy that would change the system, the immediate response of those who benefit by the current system is to block it. We're certainly pronounced in my country, much more than in yours, where any initiative to try and come up with a constructive solution is immediately blocked by those who think that they would be disadvantaged by the change. And since it's easier to stop something than it is to promote it, it means we are just in a condition of being locked up.
Mm-hmm. So then at what level you to act? Is it about, you know, in where you live, with just with you and your family, your neighbors, you know, where do you recommend to those who want to do something about preparing for it? You know, how do you go by it?
When you ask how to act, of course, the question is, what's your goal? If your goal is a comfortable life for yourself, you know, there's one set of actions you might wish to pursue. If your goal is to deal with climate change, there's a whole different set of actions. That question doesn't have a universal abstract answer. You need to look at the specific conditions, you know. So when I give speeches, often people will come up and say, what can I do? And you know, I take that question seriously. But the serious answer is we would have to talk about it for half an hour before I could have any basis for making an answer. What are your goals? What are your resources? What kind of constraints are you operating under? You know, who else is interested in the same thing? Only once those questions have an answer can you start to develop a concrete plan of action. I'll state again, there are positive, concrete plans of action available to all of us. All of us, everyone, high and low, has at each moment the possibility to do many different things. Some of those will make the situation worse than it would have been. Some of them will make the situation better than it would have been. And of course, our challenge is to identify the latter set.
But I get, because since also you discussed about, you mentioned the fact that this is about changing the culture also to avoid the worst situation. I guess that you have some ideas, for example, what are the types of values, for example, that someone should teach his children, you know, to build resilience or to start building a different type of culture.
So I'm a very concrete guy. I have trouble dealing with theoretical abstract questions. Let me put this in the concrete. I have a close friend. She's a mother. She came to me and she said, you know, I believe what you're saying about the future. I have two young boys. What should I teach them so that they will be able to live a long and satisfying life? So what did I say? Now I have a concrete problem to solve. So here are some things I said to her. Teach them some practical skills. You know, how to be a plumber, how to put pipes together, or how to be an electrician. So practical skills, how to grow food. Not that they will make that into a career, but that it is something they have to fall back on. Teach them that to be happy means to have enough, not always to have more. You know, now it's an interesting experiment. Go to your friends, say, are you happy? Why? And typically they will talk about a rate of change. I'm happy because I have more money or a bigger house or a faster car than I had last year. Presumably next year I won't be happy unless it's even still bigger, faster, etc. Rather, happiness can be that you have enough. There are two ways to be happy. What is happiness? Happiness is getting what you want, by definition. If you don't have what you want, then you're not happy. If you're unhappy, there's two ways to become happy. Get more or want less. Get more leads to collapse. Want less provides a foundation for a sustainable future. No guarantee, but a possibility.
We're getting to the end. What gives you hope about the next few decades?
So here again, I have my own aspirations. I hope I'll still be alive two decades from now. That would make me very happy. For the planet, I know that two decades from now, the climate will be much less convenient for us than it is now. There's nothing we can do now that is going to avoid several centuries of change in the climate, maybe several millennia. That doesn't mean it's not useful to reduce greenhouse gas emissions and do other measures, but it just means it isn't going to take us back to the way things were in the 90s. I hope that people could start to have a realistic understanding of the options they have, instead of just imagining or hoping that the current situation is going to go away and it's going to return to normal. I mean, it's been fascinating to watch the progress of the pandemic as it impacted the economy. Governments everywhere have been spending phenomenal amounts of money, desperately trying to keep things going, until it can get back the way it was. That's not going to happen. I have been observing the degrowth movement, which I think probably originated in France, where décroissance actually has a more elevated meaning than it does with its English translation. I hope that the underlying principles of degrowth could become much more widely accepted and pursued and respected. Unfortunately, it isn't going to happen with the current name. I'm very unhappy about the choice of degrowth as a banner or a logo for this movement, because it's an inherently negative term. If you go to a politician and say, I have some policies to promote degrowth, would you like to hear them? Most politicians are going to say they don't. I have a dear Japanese friend, a woman who has wanted to create in Japan a degrowth movement. And I said, great, but don't call it that. So she has named her society the Society for Human Happiness. Same goals, same policies. But now when she goes to a politician and says, I want to talk to you about some policies to achieve better human happiness, are you interested? Of course, the politicians offer her a chair to sit down. They want to talk about it, although it's identically the same thing, just a matter of labeling. I hope that we can come through this transition period without resorting to severe violence. I mean, there are many scenarios when you see the weapons which are available today, where countries which are unwilling to accept what lies ahead, desperately try to avoid it, by coercing other regions in one way or another. That leads to conflict. I hope that's one of my hopes, that we can avoid conflict. Now, nothing about violent conflict is going to make our problems easier to solve. I hope that the polarization which is going on between different religions and different political ideologies could moderate, and people would become more interested in looking at the underlying facts. You know, there's sort of two ways to form an opinion. One is you identify what the relevant facts are, you look at them, and then you adopt the opinion that they seem to justify. That's how I came to believe in climate change. The opposite way is that you decide what opinion you like, and then you look around for the facts that justify it. That's the approach of those who still deny climate change, or who still deny the efficacy of vaccines for the virus, etc. I would hope that we would drift back to the former point of view. I don't have any realistic expectations that's going to happen, but that is, you asked me for my hopes, that's one of my hopes.
Thanks a lot. Last question, which is often a very difficult one. Do you have one or two books that you would recommend anyone to read in this life?
Yeah. Well, now I feel embarrassed because some of the world's great literature has been written in French, which is a language I am not fluent in. So I'm simply not familiar with some of the greatest works from your country. I'm sure you have French equivalents to these things, but I can't make recommendation for you, but I can tell you some things that have had a big influence on my own thinking. One of the most important books I ever read was called in English, The Structure of Scientific Revolution by Thomas Kuhn. It's a description of how people's paradigms, their mental images, their organizing concepts can shift. You know, he uses as an example the debate that went on the evolution of the continents. When I was a small student in school, I learned that the great continents, the American continent, European continent, and so forth, were formed by rainfall falling on the mountains and eroding the dirt into the sea. And that's how we got our continents. Then, after I passed through that period, scientific evidence mounted that actually the continents had once been part of a single landmass, which had slowly broken up and migrated across the planet. Now it seems obvious. Nobody questions that at all. But there were decades of bitter debate between the geographers who had built up their reputation and their careers on the idea of a eroding landmass, and against the young scientists coming up, looking at the data and saying, no, it just didn't work that way. You weren't talking about scientific facts. You were talking about professional reputations and careers. And even in an area where the physical evidence is so clear, there were decades of dispute. In other areas, now about the pandemic or climate change or what to do about inequity or any of the, there's enormous dispute. We hold a set of paradigms which worked quite well over the last two centuries. They don't work anymore. The paradigms we have that underlie our government, our economics, and so forth, were well adapted for a period when growth was possible. They don't work in a period when growth is not possible, and we have to shift over. Thomas Kuhn's book gave me an interesting example of how difficult that is. There are many other more concrete examples. You can study the enormous difficulty of bringing into naval warfare theory the technology which lets ships know their longitude. Crucially important question, but it took decades of fights between watchmakers and astronomers to decide how it was going to be done. We're in that period now where the degrowth paradigm is in conflict with the pro-growth paradigm, and it's resolving itself. 100, 200 years from now, these things will be worked out. But Thomas Kuhn's book gives an interesting sort of understanding of how that happens. A second class of books, which I have found very useful, are ones which I call long history. They're books which study the underlying physical, social, political dynamics of a empire system. You know, the Romans, the Phoenicians, the Mongols, the Han Chinese, whatever, Carthaginians. Learning how it is that a society come together, organize, their society matures, becomes more powerful, and then eventually peaks out and declines. Understanding that we're not immune from those forces. We are a part of them. It gives you a more detached and, I think, somewhat useful perspective on what's currently happening.
Thank you so much for your time, Mr. Meadows, and thanks again, more importantly, for your work.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to join you.
Voilà, la conversation est finie. J'espère que vous avez apprécié, que vous avez appris des choses. N'hésitez pas à me le dire, à m'écrire pour ça. Et avant de vous quitter, je voulais vous dire trois choses. D'abord que vous pourrez bientôt retrouver la traduction de cette conversation sur sismic.fr sur la page de l'épisode. Ensuite, comme toujours, si le podcast vous plaît, que les questions que j'aborde vous intéressent et que vous souhaitez aller plus loin, je vous invite à rejoindre la communauté sismique privée sur Discord, dans laquelle nous sommes bientôt 200 à discuter presque quotidiennement sur les épisodes, à aussi avoir des conversations avec certains des invités, et puis dans laquelle on échange régulièrement via visioconférence. Et toutes les informations sont là encore sur sismic.fr, sur la homepage. Et enfin, si vous souhaitez soutenir ce projet, parlez-en, suivez Sismic sur les réseaux, et vous pouvez aussi faire un don sur Tipeee ou Patreon. Ça me permet d'y consacrer chaque jour un peu plus de temps. Merci d'être là, merci pour votre écoute et à très vite.
Changer le monde ? Quelle drôle d'idée ! Il est très bien comme ça, le monde, pourquoi changer ?